Welcome to worship. We're glad you're here. Thanks for joining us online for Gravel Hill Worship today. We have a few announcements. The first one is that through the month of August, we will be practicing live streaming of the worship service. So what that means for you is that worship might look a little bit different online. That's because we are recording live and putting it up on the internet for you to access. We're hoping that by September, we will have perfected live streaming and be able to do that on Sunday mornings when we begin to gather together. We have no other announcements today, and we have no other prayer requests other than those that are listed in the bulletin. So we encourage you to look at those and pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ. And as we go into worship now this morning, we have a special treat. We have Diane Kupstas singing for you the song Healer. That is a wonderful praise and worship song that you can sing along with. We thank you for joining us today. We encourage you to sing, worship, and praise God through online worship. Thank you. Have a great day.
You hold my every moment. You calm my raging seas. You walk with me through fire and heal all my disease. I trust in you.
Greetings, everyone. Welcome to our worship service here at Gravel Hill. As you can see, we're doing things a little bit differently this week for our online worship. We are trying to try new things to get us ready for live streaming and getting us ready for when we're ready to return to the sanctuary in the coming weeks. We're still set for September 6th at this point, but we're trying some new things so that even when we're online, or even if you don't join us on September 6th, you still have a real Gravel Hill experience when you are worshiping online. So we're trying to do some more live things here in the sanctuary and make sure that I still remember how to preach in person instead of just looking at myself in a camera. So we're glad that you are joining us for worship this week, and we hope that you enjoy your time and find some meaning in it. This was the week that we were planning on returning to in-person worship services initially, before we had to postpone that a little bit, but we are glad that we are able to be in here and do some live recording for you today. With this week, I wanted to introduce a new sermon series with you. The first couple sermons that I've done have focused a lot on this idea of love, because I think that is the real heart of what it means for us to worship God, and I think that that is real the heart of the gospel. But moving forward, I want to focus on what it means for us to be the church, because I think that's a question that we really need to revisit and to look back on as we live through this time of upheaval in some ways. Our current situation, we have a lot of things that are uprooted, a lot of our routines, our normals, our ways of doing life, and it can be disorienting in many ways. I think when I talk to people about how the last few months, as we've sort of had to change things around and haven't been able to really do what we normally do, a lot of people feel disoriented, and it comes up in many different ways. But our response to disorientation sometimes is that we try to hold on to the way that things were. Sometimes when we're disoriented, we try to look back and say, let's hold on to what we thought things were or the way things were, and we're holding on to something that really isn't there anymore. And when we try to hold on to things and keep them from changing, that really doesn't solve our sense of disorientation. What we really need to do is reorient ourselves to the situation that we find ourselves in. So we need a sense of reorientation. And when I say that word, what I mean is we need to re-examine our values, take a look at our values, take a look at those core things about who we are and why we worship and our mission, and reframe those things into our current situation. So it's not changing who we are, it's not changing our values, but it's saying, hey, why is it that we do the things that we do, and how can we adapt those to the situation we find ourselves? I think it's an important time in the life of the church to refresh ourselves on what those values are. What does it mean to be the church? What does it mean to be the people of God? Because I think often we are already asking those questions as so much of our faith, life, and community has been changed or challenged or put on hold in the circumstances that we find ourselves in. So for the next few weeks, I want to walk through the book of Acts and highlight what I see as some of those key values, those key characteristics on what it means for us to be the church, but that are also adaptable to whatever circumstances we find ourselves in. You know, many times throughout history, the church lived through major difficulties and cultural shifts. But the good news is that there's a promise of God that we find in the scriptures that tell us that no matter what we face, no matter what those major difficulties or shifts are, that the church will continue to find a way to be relevant. The church will continue to find a way to do the mission and work of God in the world. Might not look the same, but it is there. We go back to the Gospels when Jesus says to Peter, "You are the rock on which I will build my church, and the gates of hell, the power of hell, will not stand against it." There's a promise in that. But we really have to wrestle with what that means to live out our core values in our own context, because context is important for us. An effective church is a contextual church. But we look throughout history. We've got thousands of years of history of the church, and when we look through it, it lived through a lot of different things and continues to do so. Famines, persecutions, political upheaval, corruption within the church itself, theological disputes, public health issues, all of these things are things that the church has experienced and lived through and in some cases even thrived in the past. There's an author, a theologian named Phyllis Tickle, who wrote a book called The Great Emergence, and she talks about how the church goes through a major shift about every 500 years. And if you look through the life of the church, you can kind of see where she's getting that from, because about 500 years or so, a little less than that, you kind of have the church developing these creeds and getting real comfortable with the Roman Empire, where they're making the Council of Nicaea and things like that. That's 300 to 500 years after the death of Christ. Then about 500 years after that, you have the split between the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church, where they start to think about church in different ways, and they have arguments and disagreements over who the Pope is and all of those things. Then 500 years after that, you get the Reformation, which gives birth to the Protestant Church and many of the denominations that we find ourselves a part of. And if you fast forward 500 years after that, guess what? That puts you in today. That puts you in our current situation, and we have been living through a change in the life of the church as people are rethinking what church means. It's already something that we've been thinking about and living through, and the situation that we've lived in the last couple of months have in some ways accelerated that. I was listening to a podcast that I like to listen to, and they talk about how the COVID pandemic that we're living through has not created so many problems as it has revealed problems that have already existed in our society. That it's revealed things and it's accelerated them, where it's brought to our attention how fragile our economy can be, or how much political distrust there is on both parties and the way that we view our leaders. It's shown how we interact as institutions with a virtual and changing world that changes very rapidly sometimes. These are things that have existed long before COVID, but we've kind of become face to face with it in this time. So what does it mean for us to be a church that exemplifies the gospel of Jesus Christ in our day and time? So what I want to do over the next few weeks is take a step back with Acts and say, why is it that we do what we do? What are some characteristics that guide us regardless of what circumstances we find ourselves in? This week I found a social media quote, or a quote that was shared on my social media that a friend had, that really kind of stuck with me and I thought was really an important way to think about what church is. It's from J.D. Greer, and it says, "The early church had no building, no money, no political influence, and yet they turned the world upside down." And I thought that that was such a powerful statement about what the church is, what the church can be, and what the church has been for thousands of years. And while we too often focus on those first things like money, power, and property, and all those things, we need to reorient ourselves and say, how do we turn the world upside down even when things seem like they're changing? And I think Acts is a great partner for us to walk through those things. Just to give you a little overview on Acts, I think it's an important book because it really forms the continuation of the story after Jesus is not here on earth anymore, at least not in an earthly form. The author of Acts is the same as the author of the Gospel of Luke, and it's a continuation of that story, and it's meant to be that because the one story ends with Jesus ascending into heaven, and then when we turn to Acts, the first story we see is Jesus ascending into heaven, and in that moment, we have the end of Jesus' earthly ministry and the beginning of the disciples asking, okay, now what do we do? The beginning of what it means for us to be the church. And right before Jesus ascended into heaven, he had this experience, and he said to his disciples, this is what you're called to do. He says, you will be inspired by the Holy Spirit to preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, he says, you're going to go to Jerusalem, to Judea and Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And that really is what happens throughout the book of Acts, that it starts in Jerusalem and it ends on the way to Rome, the ends of the earth. But at the beginning of it and at the core of what it means for the church to be the church, and Jesus said it in his last words to his disciples before he ascended into heaven, was, he says, you will be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I think our first and maybe most important thing that we talk about when we talk about what does it mean for us to be the church, or what is a value or a characteristic of what the church looks like and needs in any time and circumstance, is that we need to be inspired. We need to be inspired by the Holy Spirit, because without that, we can't do anything else on behalf of God in the world. And that story comes from the story of Pentecost. The story that many of us, if you've been to church and been going to church for many years, are familiar with. It's from the book of Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. And let me read that story for you about how the Holy Spirit comes to the disciples initially. It says, when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rushing of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native tongue of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, are these not all who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others sneered and said, they were filled with new wine. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. He said, men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet of Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know, this is one of those stories that I think sometimes we become a little too familiar with, meaning that we see it, we read it, we know it so much that we sometimes forget how amazing of a story it really is. Because you have all the disciples gathered together, kind of locked in a room, which is pretty much what they've done since Jesus was crucified and resurrected. We find them there a lot in those stories. But they're doing what Jesus told them to do. When Jesus ascended, he said, go and wait for the Holy Spirit to come. And this is the story of how that happens. But it's a pretty incredible scene where you have Jesus basically, or the Spirit of God basically breaking down all the windows and the doors and rushing in like a violent wind. And then you have tongues of flame on everybody's head, and everyone starts to speak in different languages that they've never spoken in before. Because remember, the disciples were all from the same general area, so they all spoke the same language. But what's so amazing about the situation is all of a sudden, inspired by the Holy Spirit, they all start to speak the languages of everyone who's in Jerusalem at that point, which would be people from all over the world, as we read in the text. Because they were there for the Feast of Pentecost, which was a Jewish festival where they gathered together and made a pilgrimage to Jerusalem to celebrate the giving of the law to Moses at Mount Sinai. It was sort of the anniversary of that. It was a celebration of that the law was theirs, and that's what separated them as the people of God. And in that moment, all of these people hear these disciples speaking in their languages. And they keep asking, what is going on? Which I think is a pretty normal way to react to that situation. Can anybody explain to me what's happening here? How can we hear them speak in our own language? They don't know our language. They're not from where we're from. How can they be telling me about God's great deeds of power? They don't know who I am or where I'm from. How do they know this? What's going on? And you hear these words of amazed and astonished and perplexed being the way that they responded to what happened at that day, which I think is pretty accurate. And then you have some who sneer, who say, well, you know, maybe they're just drunk. That's why they're doing that. But I've never heard of being drunk giving you the ability to speak in languages that you don't know. But that's just me. But I think what we find in here is that people are really searching for a way to interpret what is happening. What does it mean for them to be inspired and filled with the Holy Spirit? Because those are words that we hear used all the time. You hear spirit, you hear breath, you hear fire, you hear filled with the Holy Spirit. And the language of Pentecost reminds us of the language of creation. The words that Luke is using here are meant to bring us back to Genesis chapter 2. That in Genesis chapter 2, the Spirit of God breathed life into dust and created human beings first. And now in Acts chapter 2, the Spirit has done it again. That the Spirit has returned and breathed new life into these once pretty cowardly disciples, and now gives Peter, who had just denied Jesus three times, the ability to stand in front of this crowd of people and proclaim who Jesus was and to proclaim what was actually going on in that situation. So Peter's the one who stands boldly and says, you might be trying to understand what's going on, but let me tell you what this is, what it means. And he says, this is the fulfillment of prophecy. It's what the prophet Joel told us about. He told us about a day when God's Spirit would fall on all people, men and women, young and old, slave and free. He says, and the Spirit of God will be poured out on all flesh, he says. And the young and the old will dream dreams and see visions, and all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And Peter says, that's what's happening here. All of this, the dramatic part of it, boils down to this, that the Holy Spirit is here. That again, we have the fulfillment of a prophecy of God that Joel so eloquently put, that this was the day when the Spirit of God would be poured out on all flesh. There's a theologian named Thomas Oden who taught at Drew University, a pretty famous, or at least in Methodist circles, a pretty popular theologian. But he talked about it, and he quoted St. Augustine, one of the great saints of the church. He said, what happens here and what happens at Pentecost is that the Spirit is no longer a transient visitor. Think about what that means. Because if you look through the text up to this point, if you go back to the Old Testament, if you go back to the stories of God throughout all of these points, you see the Spirit of God showing up in many different ways. But it's usually for a specific reason or a special occasion or some really dramatic moment where the Spirit of God shows up. But what happens in the Acts story, what happens at Pentecost, is that that Spirit is here to stay. Guess what? The Holy Spirit is moving in, and you're not getting rid of him. The Holy Spirit's there, and it's not just going to come and go anymore, but it's going to be poured out on all people and be, as St. Augustine said, a perpetual comforter and an eternal inhabitant. That once you get that Spirit, it doesn't go anywhere else. Which again is a fulfillment of a promise from Jesus, who said that those who obey my teaching, those who follow me, we will come to him and make our home with him, Jesus says in John chapter 14. But what's so beautiful about this, not only that the Holy Spirit is with us and isn't going anywhere, but the beauty of the gift of the Spirit in this moment is that it transcends all human barriers. Even more than Peter understands with what he's saying at that moment, which we'll get to later in Acts, where he says, the Spirit of God is poured out on all flesh. And then later, Peter has a hard time understanding that that means the Gentiles too. But that's what we still struggle with. Craig Keener, who was one of my professors and wrote a commentary on Acts, talked about Acts as kind of this transition in the narrative from heritage to mission. And that for so long, the people of God, they've been relying on how they've received this heritage, and they have this tradition as being God's chosen people. But in Acts, we have that shift away from holding on to heritage to moving into God's world of mission, and who that means and what that means. The beauty of this prophecy for us, just as it was for those early disciples or the people listening to the disciples, is that the Spirit of God is here, and it's for all of us. That's at the root, that's at the heart of what it means to be the people of God. We are a people who are inspired by God to see visions and dream dreams and have confidence to go out into the world and proclaim the kingdom of God, which was what the point was from the beginning. We are an inspired people, and I mean that in the best sense of the word, inspired. We are filled by the Spirit, the fire, the breath of God to fulfill God's mission in the world, even when we don't fully understand what that is, and that's the beauty of it. But what it means more than anything is that we're not a complacent people. Being inspired by the Holy Spirit means that we can't rest on our own heritage or what we have in the past or even on our own abilities or our own gifts or talents. We are inspired, which means that we're constantly learning about God and encountering God in different ways and different people, and we're constantly being pushed out of our comfort zones. That's what the story of Acts is. It's people being pushed out of their comfort zones by the Spirit of God, and that there's no room for arrogance in being inspired. Because when we become arrogant, it implies that we have the answers and we know everything already. But when we rely on the Spirit of God, and when we commit ourselves to preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit, there is no way for us to think that we know it all. The Spirit of God is poured out on all flesh. That means each and every one of us. That's the beauty of Pentecost. But that also means that it's communal. It means that we need each other. It means that we all participate together, and that the Spirit of God is a communal spirit. The early disciples knew at this point that they were in for an incredible journey. And what we'll explore over the next couple weeks is that journey. And what we learn about the church, about the people of God, and what our mission and our purpose is because of it. But it all begins here. It all begins in the story of Pentecost. It all begins with being inspired by the Holy Spirit. Because without being inspired, without being filled with the Spirit, the other lessons and experience that we learn along the way would be meaningless. The same that was true for the disciples is true for us today as well. Anyone who commits to following God and proclaiming Jesus Christ is in for an incredible journey that will require a lot of hard lessons, mistakes, failures, times of growth, and we all need the Holy Spirit to open our eyes to it. Are you inspired today? Are you filled with the power of the Holy Spirit? Are you willing to have the Spirit of God, as one of my favorite hymns in the hymnal, the Spirit of the Living God, puts it, that the Spirit will melt you and mold you and fill you and use you? As God's church, the Holy Spirit is meant to be our breath. It's our life. It's our passion. It awakens us from complacency and comfort and calls us to a mission that is uncomfortable as we go out into the world and make disciples. But in order for us to go out into the world and make disciples, we first have to be made disciples. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. Find your inspiration, find your passion, and find the ways that God is moving in your life. Go back to that quote that I shared at the beginning that said, the early church had no building, no money, no political influence, and yet they turned the world upside down. It's a reminder to us, especially in difficult times when we don't really know what the future holds and we're kind of in this limbo period now, that the church doesn't need a whole lot to turn the world upside down. It doesn't need money, it doesn't need a building, it doesn't need political power or influence. But what the church needs is a spirit to inspire. I need a spirit to inspire. You need a spirit to inspire. So our question is, and our goal is, and our mission is, and my challenge to you today is to find where that inspiration lies and go to where God has called you to be. Go, be filled with the Holy Spirit, and turn the world upside down. Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, you are a God who is here. You are a God who's not a visitor who comes and goes, but we have the promise that we've been filled with the Holy Spirit and that you are here with us, that you're an eternal inhabitant with us, that you are our perpetual comforter, and that you are inspiring us to have our lives changed and to change the world around us. God, we live in times that disorient us. And as we begin this journey over the next couple weeks, we pray for the same inspiration that your earliest disciples received, that same spirit that filled them to change who they were and to learn more about who you are and what your Spirit is calling them to do, that we would have that same openness to that Spirit. God, we know that we can do nothing apart from you, that your Holy Spirit fills us and moves us and inspires us to go out into the world. So my prayer today, our prayer today, is that you fill us with that Holy Spirit. Challenge us, push us out of our comfort zones, call us into mission, because we know that your Spirit will be there with us. Lord, help us be a people who turn the world upside down for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord.